Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the International Bicentenary Conference on Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. Please welcome Professor Flavio Gregori, who is the Provost for the Cultural Activities of Ca' Foscari University.
Good afternoon. On behalf of the rector of Ca' Foscari University, Professor Bugliesi, I have the honor and pleasure to welcome you all to Venice, first of all, to Ca' Foscari, and to the conference on Frankenstein. This is an important conference and an important occasion for you to celebrate. The celebration, as you could see, goes hand in hand, if I may say so, with the celebration which we are doing right now in this university of our 150th birthday. So Frankenstein is a bit older than Ca' Foscari. I don't know whether he would like to go hand in hand with us or whether we would like to go hand in hand with him. Never mind, I think the two celebrations have something in common in the sense of providing us with the occasion for memory. As university, we have, I think, not only we, but all universities have a great importance in this world because we educate people and also we transmit the memory of the past, of culture, of civilization, or whatever allows people to stay together. We pass it to the new generations. A conference on Frankenstein is also a way of remembering an important work of art, an important novel in the English and in the international canon. Its author, all the works that converged to create that that novel, the background to it, the various allusions to contemporary and previous cultures and to classics and so on, things you know far better than I do. So celebrations as this one, inscribed within the Ca' Foscari celebration, is very important, is very dear to us. So this is the reason why we are very happy to host this conference as university and as representative of the university's board. Grateful to the organizers, to Professor Michela Vanon, first of all, to Professor Scarsella as well, and all the organizers of this event, to the delegates who came here to talk about and discuss on Frankenstein and related matters. To all the participants, to all the students who I'm very pleased to see here for the reason I've just mentioned, that this is an occasion for us to pass knowledge, to pass memory to them in the hope that they in turn will do the same in the future. So thank you very much for all the organization. Thank you very much for bringing Frankenstein to Venice. I don't know whether in the long series of films and parodies on Frankenstein, there is a Frankenstein in Venice. I don't think so. There is a Dracula. There's a terrible Dracula in Venice played by Klaus Kinski. So maybe one day some director may be interested in playing, you know, performing, producing a film on Frankenstein in Venice. I would like to see him, you know, treading over the bridges, etc. Jokes apart, thank you very much indeed, and buon lavoro.
Okay, 200 years ago, Mary Shelley, a reserved young girl, published anonymously her first novel, which proved to be one of the most successful, disturbing, and haunting stories of all time. Conceived as a divertissement during a wet and genial summer in Switzerland, and born from her own experiences of loss and abandonment, from her anxieties about pregnancy and parenting, Frankenstein is indeed much more than a hideous story, more than a gothic classic. It is, among other things, a morally probing meditation on creation and parental responsibility, on the lust for power and ambition, on the dangers of medical experiments, as well as an exploration of the principles of liberty and human rights so dear to Mary Shelley parents, famous radical writers of the day. It is a novel which can indeed claim the status of a myth so profoundly resonant with contemporary audiences are its ethical, political implications. It has inspired stage and film adaptations. It has become a shorthand for innovation, for technological innovation in human biology, in science. Think about the creation of a hybrid of a man-sheep. And inevitably, it has spawned an impressive amount of divergent critical interpretations. The best thing, I think, about this international conference is the international perspective that panelists coming from all over the world, from Asia, from America and Canada, and obviously from all over Europe, will bring to these discussions. And I do hope you will enjoy these 2 days of debate and networking. Thank you all for your participation and welcome all here in Venice.
Thank you for being here. I welcome you to this international celebration of the bicentenary of Frankenstein, encouraged by Mary Shelley's own words when she wrote, "Beloved Italy, you are my country, my hope," and we do hope that is going to be what we get here, the pleasure of being confident that the author would not only have been pleased, but would also have felt at home. As we know, Mary Shelley had a special relationship with Italy, of which she knew the geography, the history, the culture, and the language, including all the variations of the many Italian dialects. Mary Shelley was unquestionably a writer with a multinational and multilingual interest. And in a way, we pay homage to this feature of hers. This conference hosts participants from various countries. As Michela was saying, we counted 15 different countries: Canada, Korea, Spain, Mexico, France, Poland, Greece, Croatia, Romania, just to name a few. And also, it hosts participants from different backgrounds: literature, physics, biology, the visual arts, journalism. There are scholars who have long worked on Frankenstein and younger researchers who have only recently approached the text, all willing to share the same enthusiasm, maybe fanatism, for Mary Shelley's novel. Another feature of this conference is multilingualism. Papers in our panels will be delivered in English, Italian, Spanish, and French, a variety of languages, which is an issue in Mary Shelley's Frankenstein as well. After all, Victor himself, who was born in Italy, spoke French, German, and English, even if with a foreign accent. Papers present various topics and approaches: dissection, race, objection, the Bible, mythology, ruins, waxworks, the sublime, sympathy, eugenics, science fiction, the supernatural. They deal with minor characters, contemporary and 19th century adaptations, human rights, death, illustrations, receptions, translations, teaching Frankenstein, films, TV series, and video games. A variety of topics and readings, which is not surprising to those who are familiar with the novel. As we underlined in the call for paper, Frankenstein is not simply a great story. It is an encyclopedia with a wide range of entries that no single conference can encompass. And luckily, we know we're not the only ones celebrating this year. There are conferences all around the world, and there will be others even after the year 2018. We know interest in Frankenstein will continue to grow. We are sure that readers who get to the end of the novel and bid farewell to the creature, lost in darkness and distance, will always want to go back to the beginning and relish the words which Captain Walton addresses to his sister, you will rejoice to hear. Thank you.
Bene, un saluto anche in lingua italiana. Questo convegno è un convegno preeminentemente di anglistica e in lingua inglese. Tuttavia, io ringrazio la professoressa Michela Vanon e la collega Maria Parrino di avermi invitato per suggerire eventuali interazioni comparatistiche facendo luce sulla ricezione del romanzo di Mary Shelley nelle letterature europee. Questo darà luogo non solo a interventi di carattere teorico, ma anche a contributi importanti tendenti a rintracciare la penetrazione del testo di Mary Shelley nelle diverse letterature, ma anche la sua riproposizione, la sua trasposizione come icona dell'immaginario letterario. Tuttavia c'è anche una componente interdisciplinare molto forte che si è inteso affiancare al punto di vista multiletterario. Naturalmente è presente il cinema che ha in qualche modo dato una seconda vita al capolavoro di Mary Shelley, ma abbiamo anche ricevuto numerose richieste di paper dedicati al fumetto e alla graphic novel. Tutto questo ci è parso particolarmente importante e stimolante, quindi in lingua italiana io auguro a tutti buon lavoro. Grazie.
Okay, at this stage I would like to introduce our first keynote speaker, Professor Marie Mulvey Roberts, who is Professor of English Literature at the University of the West of England, Bristol. Her teaching and research interests include Gothic and gender. In 1998, she edited the Handbook to Gothic Literature, which has been recently translated into Japanese. And more recently, she published British Poets and Secret Societies, 2014. She is the co-founder and editor of Women's Writing on Historical Women Writers, for which she co-edited a special issue on Mary Shelley. And she has indeed published many works on Mary Shelley. Her most recent books, Dangerous Bodies, Historicizing the Gothic Corporal, winner of last year's Annie Lloyd Smith Prize, and Literary Bristol, Women and the City, have chapters on Frankenstein. With Carol Davidson, she has edited Global Frankenstein, and her films on Frankenstein and its links to Bristol and Bath are included in a massive open online course run by the English Start at the University of West of England on the literally Southwest. So please welcome Professor Marie Mulvey Roberts.
Well, it's a great honor to be giving the keynote at this very prestigious conference in such a glorious setting. And I thank the organizers so much for inviting me and for bringing us here together today. Well, as you can see here, we have an anatomical Venus from Florence. And I thought that was an appropriate opening to my talk on monstrous dissections, race, performance art, and the Bride of Frankenstein. And the 19th century surgeon and anatomist, William Lawrence, who was known to the Shelleys, referred to dissection as a dirty source of knowledge. And this would have been apparent to Percy Shelley during his training as a surgeon at St. Bartholomew's Hospital in London. Now, it's not known if Percy Shelley had the opportunity to observe or participate in a dissection, but his response to this, to the sight of the flaying of Marsalis in a sculpture, does betray a certain insider knowledge when he insisted, "If the sculptor knew as much as the moderns about anatomy, then I hope to God he did not." So like Victor Frankenstein, Percy Shelley may have been confronted with a sight of corpses. And Victor's revulsion of his creature is because what he's looking at is a living cadaver whose shriveled complexion, we're told, bears the inscription of the dead, I quote, "with yellow skin which scarcely covered the work of muscles and arteries beneath." Now, this description in the novel, along with the frontispiece to the 1831 edition, resembles the muscular anatomical drawings by Renaissance anatomists such as Vesalius or here in De Muscis's book. During the Renaissance, the anatomical theatre, designed for teaching purposes, was a place of corporeal display, or in other words, a theatre of the body. And more recently, Gunther von Hagen's first public dissection of a human body in 170 years was a sellout to 500 people in a London theatre, for which he earned the media sobriquet of Dr. Frankenstein. The event was denounced as a freak show, not least because the ticketed theatrical setting smacked of the exploitative commodification of the dead for entertainment. The performative aspects of this were seen in von Hagen's approach as a showman, whose costume included, as always, the black fedora hat, which his critics interpreted as showing disrespect towards the corpse. And his defense was that he wore it out of respect for his predecessors and in imitation of that worn by the anatomist here in Rembrandt's The Anatomy Lesson of Dr. Nicholas Tulp of the 17th century. The public dissection was televised in 2002 on the UK's Channel 4 and prompted complaints. The provisions of the Anatomy Act of 1984 rendered public autopsy a criminal act, which is why police officers were present, though they did not intervene, while Frankenstein's skills in anatomy are displayed by creating a living creature, and von Hagen creates simulations of life through dissecting dead bodies. After skinning each corpse, he uses plastination, a form of preservation that positions animals and human cadavers or body parts in performative poses, as you can see here, which are then exhibited in a number of public spaces, including art galleries. To date, approximately 200 corpses are on display in von Hagen's Macabre Cadaver Museum in Berlin. With their blood vessels and muscles exposed, this gruesome parody of a mass vivant tableau is the ultimate striptease. And von Hagen has also aroused controversy as a modern-day Frankenstein by allegedly illicitly obtaining dead bodies for his travelling corpse art and scientific exhibition Body Worlds, which was visited by 40 million people in approximately 90 cities and countries. Von Hagen's won an injunction against the German newspaper Der Spiegel, which he alleged he'd exhibited for the paying public the bodies of executed Chinese prisoners without their permission. And indeed, there's been a long tradition of putting the bodies of murderers on public display. After committing murder, Frankenstein's monster, with a telling Latin root of monere to warn, becomes a living embodiment of the walking criminal corpse. In James Whale's film of 1931, Frankenstein, Igor, the scientist's assistant, supplies a criminal brain for transplanting into the creature's cranium, parodied here in the film Young Frankenstein. And I love how it says there, as you can see, do not use this brain, abnormal. and the criminality of body snatching would not have been lost on the viewer. The father of modern anatomy, the pioneering surgeon John Hunter, who can be seen as a model for Victor Frankenstein, attended the dissection of more than 2,000 human bodies, while his payment for corpses to supply his anatomy school helped trigger the trade in body snatching. He also experimented in animal transplants. And in the novel, Victor raids slaughterhouses, as well as the charnel houses, for animal parts for his creature. It was feared by the Edinburgh anatomist, Dr. Robert Knox, that exposing an artist to, I quote, the mangled and dissected dead could be detrimental to his art. And he went on to declare, I quote, that no artist should enter a charnel house called a dissecting room, for in such a place his mind may become accustomed by frequent contemplation to all that is detestable, familiar with horrors, with the emblems of destruction and death. This process of desensitization provides an insight into the moral and spiritual deterioration of Victor Frankenstein, whose workshop of filthy creation is where he forfeits his humanity, manifested by his revulsion towards his handiwork through his rejection of his creature and the tearing apart of the female monster, which resembles an act of anatomical dissection. Cutting up dead women for teaching purposes was fraught with controversy. There was the unsettling possibility of one's wife, sister, or mother being subjected to the gaze of lads learning to use the incision knife. And a reversal of this occurs in the novel. When Victor Frankenstein is in the process of creating the living from the dead, in the form of a female creature as a mate for his monster, and espies, I quote, the demon at the casement, and who now has come to mark my progress. And this is rather like a medical student observing an autopsy or surgical procedure. Dissection on female cadavers was regarded by many as a violation of female modesty, and worse still, as a form of sexual assault. At St. Bartholomew's Hospital, where Percy Shipp trained, there's the horrifying story in 1815 of a porter who, in front of medical students, committed necrophilia on the corpse of an attractive 15-year-old girl. In many ways, dissection is a process of gradual desexualization, and this has been particularly problematic for the female subject, who tends to be defined by her sex. The dissolution of human identity also involves a process of dehumanization. In Frankenstein, the opposite takes place. When Victor, after tearing apart, quote, the thing on which he'd been engaged, sees in the fragmented remains the vestiges of coherent humanity. As he put it, the remains of the half-finished creature whom I had destroyed lay scattered on the floor. And I always felt as if I had mangled the living flesh of a human being. He also, of course, has destroyed the monster's hope for reproducing a new species. John Hunter's brother and fellow anatomist William was especially keen on dissecting the corpses of pregnant women in order to penetrate the mysteries of procreation, the most secret of nature's hiding places. It was a rarity to dissect a pregnant cadaver, especially in the late stages. So when Hunter got a lucky break in acquiring five pregnant bodies between 1750 and 1754, he was able to carry out pioneering research. This provided his brother with the necessary materials for his groundbreaking anatomical drawings of fetal development in the anatomy of the human gravid uterus of 1774. A famous dissection of a supposedly pregnant female corpse was witnessed in 1814 by William Harwood, a friend of Mary Shelley's father, William Godwin. This was conducted on the body of Joanna Southcott, the millenarian prophetess who had a cult following of 10,000. Arguably the exponent of a kind of theological feminism, her rehabilitation of Eve, the first mother of mankind, aimed to restore every woman to her true role as helpmate to their Adam. And there are parallels with the bride Victor is creating and Joanna Southcott, the self-appointed bride of the Lamb, who believed that through an immaculate conception she'd give birth to the divine Shiloh, a biblical prophetic name for the Messiah. And she even managed to persuade at least 17 doctors of her pregnancy. In the event of her premature death, she insisted that no medical examination should proceed until at least 4 days after her death. The examiner ran a report in early 1815, recounting how her disciples kept the body warm in order to preserve the vital spark before the 4 days have elapsed. And of course, in the creation scene in Frankenstein, Frankenstein refers to the spark of being. The dissectors, Mr. Rees and Mr. Want, were the surgeons dissecting Southcott's remains, described in the newspaper as their disgusting task, only to discover an empty, shrunken womb. The dashed expectations of her followers correspond to the disappointment of the monster, devastated by the loss of a companion and mate for his monstrous progeny. Both the female monster and Joanna Southcott embodied the promise of apocalyptic change through the act of giving birth, whilst their bodies were subjected to scientific curiosity epitomised by the medical gaze. And this cartoon you can see by Thomas Rowlandson is a satiric reminder of how the female body could be immodestly invaded through dissection and subject to the voyeurism of the anatomists. I like the subtitle, Miracles Will Never Cease. I think they certainly did when they found that the womb was empty. The preservation of female body parts, which normally found their way into pathology labs, could also give rise to romantic and erotic inferences. Thomas Hood's comic poem, Mary's Ghost, a pathetic ballad, resurrects the voice of a dead woman complaining to her fiancé about the robbing of her grave, which led to her remains being divided up amongst various doctors, including Sir Astley Cooper, a leading surgeon and anatomist during the first half of the 19th century. And this is an extract from the poem. And this is Mary's voice to her fiancé. I vowed that you should have my hand, but fate gives us denial. You'll find it there at Doctor's Bell, in spirits and a file. As for my feet, my little feet, you used to call so pretty. There's one I know in Bedford Row, the others in the city. I can't tell where my head has gone, but Dr. Carpoo can. As for my trunk, it's all packed up to go by Pickford's van. The cock it crows, I must be gone. My William, we must part. But I'll be yours in death, although Sir Astley has my heart. A real-life example of the eroticization of female body parts can be seen in the case of the African woman, Saatchi, or Sarah Bartman, exhibited in life as well as death. Particular attention was paid to her extreme sciofiga, or protruding buttocks, and prominent pudenda. Tellingly, she was known as the Hottentot Venus, and put on public display in Piccadilly, London, in the spring of 1811, not far from where Percy Shelley was living in Soho that year. Now, even though she was never an actual slave, her exploitation has been seen as a form of enslavement, and that is relevant to readings of Frankenstein as a novel encoding the horrors of slavery. And indeed, as Peter Kitson has pointed out, her post-mortem dissection has often been seen to parallel Victor Frankenstein's tearing apart of his female monster. Now, the reintegration of the bride of Frankenstein, ripped apart by Victor Frankenstein, is evidenced from the work of French performance artist Orlan, whose digital portrait here is modeled on Elsa Lanchester's eponymous role in James Whale's film Bride of Frankenstein of 1835. Orlan uses the figure of the monster's mate as an empowering symbol of female monstrosity. It aptly expresses how she becomes the first artist to use surgery as an artistic medium, reconstructing her face as a pastiche of other faces, and thereafter digitally transforming it in line with racial hybridity. As a radical female artist, Orlan uses her body as art to reclaim it from a society that perpetuates gender inequalities. Like the bride of Frankenstein, the 18-year-old Orlan renounced the prospect of marriage, as we can see in this cartoon, the dawning of why she's needed. And her method was actually to soil the trousseau linen squirreled away by her mother for her wedding, and she turned them into a canvas using sperm donated by lovers. She stitched deliberately badly, bad embroidery over the stains, thereby rejecting her traditional female role and the custom of the bridal sheets, you know, being used to denote the bride's state of virginity through the inscription or not of hymenal blood. For her installation, called Medusa's Head, Orlan hung up the sheets and cut a hole in them, through which she displayed her own genitals as a protest against the Freudian phallic notion of female lack. This voluntary act of self-exposure contrasts with how the genitals of the Hottentot Venus were exhibited after her death and without her consent at, and I think it's very ironic, the name of the museum in Paris where her genitals were displayed, the Museum of Man. Orlan also uses the wedding trousseau, the fabric, as a drape in the manner of religious iconography along the lines of Bernini's Saint Teresa in Ecstasy, and also classical artwork of the Virgin Mary exposing a breast in imitation of the nursing Madonna. This statement pronounced that she'd given birth to herself through art, thereby allowing for multiple rebirths, most notably through the cult of Saint Orlan, and of course a rebirth through through the Bride of Frankenstein. So that's her giving birth to her mythologized self, and there's something about the cult of Saint Orlan. So her personal attack on religious belief and myth led ironically to the creation of her own mythological and sanctified self. And in this regard, Orlan's identification with the Bride of Frankenstein ties in with Mary Shelley's creation of a new birth myth. Like Victor Frankenstein, Orlan makes use of dissection to create a monstrous composite. But instead of plundering graves and charnel houses, she harvests body parts from art galleries, her own face becoming a canvas for her art. And during her surgery performances, a surgeon carved and remodeled her flesh into a montage of the eternal feminine. And, you know, she uses Italian artists as well for this, derived from the canon of Western art, in what can be seen as a parody of the Frankenstein project. So her mouth was transformed into that of Boucher's Europa, her chin to Botticelli's Venus, her nose to Jerome's Psyche, and her forehead brow to Leonardo's Mona Lisa. Orlan's goal had never been one of beautification, but rather to deconstruct notions of female beauty and disrupt the codes of cosmetic surgery. And a more recent development of this has been the surgical implants in her forehead resembling horns, though she denies the horns, and she's been lately been in a legal clash with Lady Gaga because she's claimed that Lady Gaga has taken the horns from one of her videos from Orlan. So like Orlan, Victor too selects beautiful individual parts for his creature, whom he refers later to as devil, only he, by contrast, ends up rejecting the sum total as hideous. Victor's reaction to his creature encapsulates the adverse effects of the gaze upon otherness. And likewise, Orlan sets out to critique the gaze in relation to the other. She pronounces that she's both male and female, and she reverses the gendered indefinite articles in French, je suis un homme et une femme. Concerning race, she strives to dissolve the kind of fear that prompted Victor Frankenstein to destroy his female monster, fearing that she would give birth to a race, he feared she would give birth to a race of devils that might destroy mankind. He was also anxious about the possibility that she might prefer mating with man because of his superior beauty, you know, rather than with the monster, thus posing the spectre of a mixing of races, and that had negative connotations at the time. But Orlan is an advocate of racial hybridity. She explains, the idea is to mix the differences in order to accept them. in order, she says, to coexist with other, an I who is also other. So, since 1998, as we can see here, she's been creating a digital photographic series called Self-Hybridizations, in which her face merges with those of different ethnicities taken from masks, sculptures and paintings from Africa, American Indian and pre-Columbian Mexican cultures. And these amalgamations set out to challenge the gold standard Europeanized aesthetic universal. So, Olan's mission has been to revolutionize notions of beauty in order to dispel the kind of horror Victor experienced when he gazed upon the face of his first creation with its yellow skin, and ethnographers have used the yellow skin to denote mixed race, and also the straight black lips. And Olan has even thought about how she might be affected if her skin color changed from white to black. Now, a more material and biological mode of racial hybridity can be seen in her multi-installation called Harlequin's Coat. In 2007, Olan collaborated with the Sambotica Laboratory in Australia, resulting in the bio-art installation called Harlequin's Coat. And this involves creating a biotechnical organic coat from the live co-culturing of cells from her own body, mixed with those of different species and races contained in a custom-built bioreactor. So by deploying this bioart, she intends one day to mix her cells with those of animals and humans and grow a new hybrid skin to further break down the binary between self and other. And I think this is an even more integrated version of how Victor Frankenstein used animal and human parts in the creation of his monster, harvested from graveyards, charnel houses, you know, slaughterhouses. Now, for her fifth operation, Olan reenacts an allegory of fabric and flesh through the symbolic racial melting pot of the Harlequin's Coat in a carnivalesque dismantling of the racialized body. And this involved a black dancer doing a strip tease in the operating theater, and that's the time she's having the operation. He sheds layers of a Harlequin's costume, and Olan is also dressed in a Harlequin's costume. Her inspiration was a book by Michael Serres called The Troubadour of Knowledge, 1997, which conceptualizes the crossbreeding of knowledge and tells the story of a Harlequin king of the sun and the moon who removes layers of his clothes. When the last layer is removed, the king's flesh is revealed to be multicolored and covered in tattoos. Olan's nine operations, taking place between 1990 and 1993, are all forms of striptease, involving the removal not of clothes, but of clothes as well, but also of layers of her own skin. As an epigraph to her surgeries, she would read from La Robe, written by Lacanian psychologist Limone Luciani, which explores the correlation between skin and clothes. In the Harlequin's Coat, Olan carries out a parody of burlesque while lying on the operating table by displaying her genitals. She's deliberately provocative in her attitudes towards gender and race in the operating theater. And before the operation, she kisses the surgeon, and she exposes her genitals also in the presence of the stripper. And you can see the stripper here on the PowerPoint. That the stripper is black appears to be a deliberate way of confronting the stereotype of the sexualized black man. His name is Jimmy Blanche, and that resonates with Frantz Fanon's Black Skin and White Masks, first written in French in 1952, and it's about the divided self-perception of the black subject who's lost sight of his origins and adopts the culture of the mother country. And his presence appears to be a commentary on cultural mimicry, reflecting race back on itself, or a reflection on how white women rather than black men are usually exploited as strippers. The surgery performance raises questions about the relationship between colonizer and colonized and the inequalities of gender and race. So when going under the knife, Olan refuses to represent the passive white female body, and she doesn't have a general anesthetic either, as opposed to the active black male body of Jimmy Blunch. Now, both participate in the striptease, but Orland's performance goes beyond the removal of clothes to the epidermis, beneath which skin colour becomes immaterial. The troubling exchange between the two mirrors the interchangeability of Victor Frankenstein and his monster. Orland's appropriation of the voyeuristic gaze is combined with a subversive, eroticized, medicalized gaze, which she turns on herself by peering into her own interior during an operation made possible by local anesthetic, you'll be reassured to know. In her manifesto, which she calls Carnal Art, Orland records how, "I can observe my own body cut open without suffering. I see myself all the way down to my entrails, a new mirror stage. I can see to the heart of my lover." Has his splendid design has nothing to do with sickly sentimentalities. "Darling, I love your spleen, I love your liver, I adore your pancreas, and the line of your femur excites me." So like Victor Frankenstein, she is in possession of a hidden, prohibited knowledge. And like him, she, quote, pursued nature to her hiding places. Only now, the hiding places are under her control. Not only does she represent female nature, she also guides the hand of male science. The surgeon sculpting her body does so according to her wishes, even allowing her to direct the camera while the operation is being filmed. Orland's refusal to be a silent patient lying passively under the knife is evident from her reading aloud from French philosophical texts, including the following passage from Lyotard's Libidinal Economy. "Open the so-called body and spread out all its surfaces, as though your dressmaker's scissors were opening the leg of an old pair of trousers. Go on, expose the small intestine's alleged interior, the jejunum, the ileum, the duodenum, or else, at the other end, undo the mouth at its corners. Pull out the tongue at its most distant roots and split it. Spread out the bat's wings of the palate and its damp basements. Open the trachea." So eventually, the body is flattened out into an immense membrane as part of Lyotard's intention to destabilize the notion of the body as a stable signifier of identity, one into which libidinal energies have been channeled and subsequently subdued. Both he and Orland set out to disrupt the hegemony of the organic body so that its fragmentation can articulate a social transformation. They jointly question the social implications of embodiment. This is a process that has liberating potential for the categories of both gender and race. Furthermore, Lyotard figures theory itself as theater and the theorist as viewing the representation of the world as if from a stage, in ways that chime with how Orland turns an operating theatre into a theatrical space. For both Frankenstein and Orland, dissection opened up a route to transformation, which collapsed distinctions between self and other. For Orland, unlike Mary Shelley's scientist, surgery is used as a means of challenging inequalities of gender and race in a celebration of otherness and a celebration of racial and sexual hybridity. Thank you very much for listening.
Don't worry, leave it there, yes. Thank you very much for this disturbingly fascinating talk, and I'm sure there will be some questions and yes, one from the back. Maybe you want to come closer or yes. Ah, Rosella, please.
This is a fascinating talk, thank you very much. But I was wondering, something which probably crossed the mind of many of us, whether there are any connections between Orland and Frida Kahlo, who painted all the insides.
That's interesting. That's a very interesting question, and it's actually one I've never thought about before. I've been interested in Frida Kahlo because last year I curated an exhibition on Angela Carter, and I was trying to get hold of Frida Kahlo's work. And one of the things I wanted in the exhibition was there's a photograph of her prosthetic leg, and it's you know, beautifully painted, and I wasn't able to get it, unfortunately. But there is an exhibition in London, I think, on her clothes and objects, that kind of thing. So the idea of body parts and Frida Kahlo was something I did want to explore. And it's quite interesting. I've never made that connection, really, that she kind of seen as another sort of bride of Frankenstein. But there's all that suffering, really, isn't it, which is so immense. And one of the things Orland says is that she does not go out of her way to suffer. She makes that quite clear. She's not a martyr, even though she's playing with the iconography of saints and martyrdom to some degree. But she sees it as a sort of joyful thing that she has these operations as transformative things. And of course, they must be painful, if not at the time, just recovering from all of that surgery. And the idea of actually, you know, having a mirror and be able to look down into your body interior. I mean, it's the ultimate taboo, the ultimate secret. So I do think these women, both Frida Kahlo and Orlan, engage with their bodies in very graphic, maybe shocking ways. And they confront us with another idea of femininity and female sexuality, really. But I think that's a fascinating link between the two of them. And it'd be interesting to know whether Orlan herself was influenced at all by Frida Kahlo. But Frida Kahlo's, you know, some of the images of the suffering are so incredibly powerful. And I think I didn't show you the most graphic illustrations of Orlan's operations. As you can imagine, there's far more graphic ones. I didn't want anybody fainting in the audience. But certainly they're out there, and I think that what Frida Kahlo does in art is equally powerful. So thank you for that. I think that's something to think about and explore a bit.
Yes, yes, please. The first slide shows the anatomical features. Okay. Could you explain how that relates to
that section? I was just very recently reading a book, The Anatomical Venus by Joanna Ebenstein, I think her name is. But I thought this was interesting because of the links with Italy. And these anatomical Venuses, this is at the Specula in Florence, and Susini's. And they were very expensive to make. And in order to make one of them, you'd have to have something like 200 corpses. And what they would do, they would use the body parts in order to mold from the plaster, you know, the plaster and then the wax. They also, I thought was quite interesting for Venice, they used something called virgin wax that was Venice wax, which suggests it is the purest kind of wax. And wax industry grew up after the plague because they wanted so many candles in churches because they didn't want people to die. And of course, with illness, as you well know, there were saints who were responsible for different parts of the body. So you'd have people praying to different parts of the bodies. And also this whole industry of saints' relics grew up. So the wax effigies of saints would become reliquaries holding the relics of the body parts. And what then happened was a transition from the sacred to the scientific, so that around 1700, a man called Zuber made the first anatomical Venus. And his endeavor was not to make it disgusting and horrible, but to make it beautiful so it could be used for medical students to study the body, so, you know, they wouldn't have to dissect bodies. And often these had, you could take them apart in about 40 places. And then, of course, at the carnival, they would have dissections at carnivals as well, and maybe who knows, sometimes there are executed criminals, but those body parts might have been even used for these anatomical Venuses. But there were anatomical Adonises as well. And then in London, I think in around 1850s, they were actually banned as obscene under the Obscene Publications Act. But they were also, these anatomical Venuses were also used as a sort of warning, really, against syphilis. So you saw these beautiful women sort of horribly disfigured by tertiary syphilis. And the exhibitions were just confined to the men. The men would go into a room only that the men were allowed to go into, and they'd see these. And as we know, people were treated with mercury if they had syphilis. And as the saying went, you know, it was a night with Venus, but a lifetime with mercury.
Any more questions? Maria?
Can you say something more about the role of the surgeon? Because, as you said, Orlan displays her body, and she decides what to do with it, right? Does that disempowers the surgeon and leaves it to the body?
Absolutely. And I was thinking, you know, mustn't it be annoying if you're a surgeon and the patient isn't, you're operating on, isn't even unconscious, but is actually saying, could you just... Stop. I'm just trying to get the best camera angle for your scalpel. Just stop. And I just think you'd have to have a very tolerant surgeon. And I think that she's trying to break down this hierarchy that the stereotype maybe is the male surgeon and the female patient, but she's trying to break down the stereotype of the power dynamic and bring about a greater sense of equality. So instead of being unconscious, she's directing, and she also has turned it into a sort of party atmosphere, a carnivalesque, really, atmosphere. But she's decorated the operating theatre. People have got costumes on. She's got books. And the other thing, she would send live relays of the operations to art galleries around the world. So she would send faxes. You can see how this is a little bit dated. What she could have done with mobile phones and Skype, you know, but effectively did sort of Skype around. So it's very much performance art in that kind of way. And also kissing the surgeon. She kind of confronts this kind of latent, we think about Foucault and the history of sexuality, talking about that, you know, eroticized maybe relationship with the doctor and the patient. She kisses the surgeon, so she's bringing that out. So she's confronting taboos by having the black stripper there, by having the surgeon kissing the surgeon, and there's an erotic element within it as well. So she's bringing these things out in a way that's very subversive. So it is very radical in so many different respects what she's doing. And I really like to, as you've heard, relate this to the Bride of Frankenstein, who is completely passive. I mean, she's never even fully formed. I mean, she's only sort of inchoate. She's not completed. She's not even there. She doesn't even say anything. And of course, the films have brought her to life, and even in The Bride of Frankenstein, she doesn't last that long with Elsa Lanchester. And then you get people like Elizabeth Hand, who's written a book about The Bride of Frankenstein, where she actually survives the fire that kills her in the film, and goes on and has all sorts of adventures, and is a feminist, and is very empowered. And so I think it's an interesting image for these artists and writers to take up The Bride of Frankenstein as this tabula rasa, you know, and to do something with her and bring her back to life. And in a way, Orlan is doing the ultimate, really, of them all, because she's directing, she's the Victor Frankenstein, she's doing the dissection in a way, and she is the dissected object. So I think it's a very clever recuperation of the Bride of Frankenstein. Thank you for that question.
Questions? No? Maybe we'll have a break before starting the first sessions. Thank you very much. Thank you for this really wonderful lecture. Thank you.